I mix what I like, what I like, what I like, what I like. All right, what's up, world? Welcome to another edition of I Mix What I Like Live right here on Black Power Media. Again, I'm Jared Ball. Happy to be your host. Definitely jump on in and tell all who you would want and think would benefit and needs to get some of this boom bap breakfast to jump on in. We have a big show today, a lot going on, and I hope my audio is good. Just making sure I'm not, okay. But welcome everybody. Greetings, hope you had a good week. I hope you've been having a good week with the Remix Morning Show and all the other fare and content coming out. Please do make sure you hit the bell so you don't miss any of your notifications for all the things that are coming up and on here again on BPM. Shout out to everybody who's going to see this later on YouTube or elsewhere, and those who will hear this later on Spotify and Google or iTunes, wherever you get your podcasts. Although we are have, as we discussed the other day on Wednesday, we definitely have a contradiction with Spotify that we'll have to continue to look at as they continue to sign defense contracts and get involved with all kinds of intelligence and surveillance and transferring our data and information, et cetera, and so forth. We don't want to certainly advocate that, but as we discussed, and if you missed that, we might come back to it later on today. But if you missed that, definitely go back and check out the Remix Morning Show from this would have been from Wednesday of this week when we covered that issue a little bit. I see my man, Brother Kaba, is here. Good morning. Greetings to you, sir. Good to see you again.
Good morning. Good morning to all you heathens. Happy holidays.
Oh, right. Is there a holiday going on right now? We're just ramping up to the winter solstice celebration?
We're just ramping up, man. But where's Jackie Lukeman, though? I just got you.
I think you just got me, unfortunately. I think that was, last week was a rare specialty. I don't know that we can expect that every Friday, but we can certainly try again. I'm out. I heard that. I'm not mad at that.
No, that was a special treat. That was a great treat to see her yesterday. I mean, last week.
It was. You know. And we try to get her on as much as possible. But definitely Sugar Booger. Spotify. Check that out. I think we'll come back to that. I think I'm going to come back to that later on in the show, because in a few minutes, we have another April Silver takeover for the first hour. Uh-oh. And then in the second hour, I think we can get to a number of different things. We were intending to have a return of a discussion of Dr. Bobby Wright's work in the second hour, but we're going to push that back to next Friday. Okay. where we're going to have a round table on Dr. Wright, because as I said, when I encourage people, you know, we, you know, I, you know, we joke about it all the time, and shout out again to my man Pierre and the good folks at Comedy Hype. But we do always encourage folks to who are not live with us in the chat, when they, if they can't be live with the remixers, that they, that anything that they, you know, want to get off their chest,
put it in the comments.
And I do check the comments as often as possible. And there was a comment criticizing me and our conversation last week with Bunchy Shakur, or Monday rather, with Yusuf Bunchy Shakur and Bobby Wright. And the short of it was, I was just simply saying we weren't per se discussing Dr. Wright, but I'm happy to revisit that. So I did endeavor to put together a roundtable, and that will take place a week from today. And so you'll hear more about that. But yeah, so we definitely want to revisit that discussion.
I'm unclear on the comment. So what was the issue that the person had about?
So the short of it was that Bunchy wanted to come on. He's going to come back, because essentially he wanted to know where we stood collectively with Black social theory and Dr. Wright's work in the academy. He's working on his PhD, so the broad question he was raising is the impact of white theory on Black bodies. And then, like, I guess if we were to put a subheading, it would have been, you know, something like, you know, where's Bobby Wright's social theory today, or something like that, Black social theory today. And so we didn't really get it, one of the commenters was saying that I just didn't, basically was saying I didn't know what I was talking about and I had not read Wright's work. And I was saying, you know, it's been a while, I admit that, but we weren't really focused on Wright that day. And what we were focused on, and what Bunchy was bringing up, was what do we do working within the university and in the academy to bring in that theory. So essentially my argument was just like with Black studies, if there is no outside broader political movement and struggle, the institution is not going to welcome that. That's not going to be a fight that's winnable. You know, you can do pockets of little things in that, but you're not going to institutionalize Bobby Wright at the University of Michigan.
I don't want it in there. I don't want it.
Well, that's a good,
the extent that you have it in there is going to be compromised, because you can only do so much. And that's something that you can't, it's all or nothing. You can't milk toast no Bobby Wright. You just can't do it. So it needs to be independent of those institutions.
I think as I remembered, at least, that was more or less my argument, that was just more or less my argument.
That's like saying you can become a good politician and work within the system. You can't, it's only so much you can do. It's only so much.
No, I mean, that's
working within the structure. The whole point, the fact that Bobby Wright had a theory in the first place is in large part because of the freaking Western Academy. I mean, because we got to remember a lot of the Hegelian stuff, the social Darwinism. These are not idiots. These are academics that created this.
That's right. That's right.
You know, taxonomy and all of that stuff. You know, that's anthropology. All of which are racist in their foundation, psychology, sociology, all of it. Mm-hmm. And it's all started in the academy. These are not idiots. People always make this argument about racism. Always people are ignorant. No, they're not. The people that came up with this stuff were academics. They were scholars. They were brilliant minds. Okay.
That's it.
They were not stupid. Thomas Jefferson was not stupid. Okay.
Ben Franklin was not stupid. That's a good, I mean, yeah, we should respect our enemies. Like, at least, you know, they were not dumb. They just, you know, were, you know,
racist,
far more well organized. Well, definitely that. Yeah. But that was sort of my point, that they were more organized. And that's the component I keep wanting us to come back to, you know, because, and again, a lot of it is personal. My initial reaction to that particular question of what we can do within the academy is personal, given my experience over the last, you know, decade or more. I'm very sensitive to this idea that we are expecting individual academics to become these sort of independent revolutionary neos inside of the matrix, working by themselves. And And even that's not a good comparison, because even Neo in The Matrix works with a team. Even he's got a crew and an organized rebellion pushing him. So like academics don't even have that at this point. So that was that. So I'm looking very much to revisiting that and doing that more specifically centering Bright's actual work. So we'll come back to that next week. In a moment when we happily cede I Mix What I Like to another April Silver takeover, in the next hour, there are some things that relate very much to what we just talked about that I do want us to get to. For instance, I was sent the clip that I had not ever seen or don't remember ever having seen or read where Kwame Ture, breaks down very quickly why we can't do things economically absent of an initial political education, organization, and analysis and struggle. In other words, he, to my liking, really does a good job in satisfying that contradiction of or that struggle between politics and economics. So I want to get into that. Talk a little bit about my exchange recently with the good brother Wise Intelligent. And some of his commenters on IG around crypto, some stuff about fintech that I want us to get into, similar related to that, these questions of cryptocurrency, financial technologies, and Black people in particular. By the way, they removed Comedy Central in them, and we'll come back to this as well. They privatized or removed the video with Dr. Claude Anderson and Charlemagne the God's co-host that we worked with the other day. So we'll talk a little bit about that. And then we have some political prisoner updates with Mutulu Shakur and Leonard Peltier that I'd like us to talk a little bit about as well. And then we'll get, you know, if we have, you know, depending on how we all do time wise in the next hour, we can also talk a little bit about the more about the Oliver Stone JFK CIA documentary that just came out. We could revisit the Spotify and defense issues. And then also I want to talk a little bit, if we can quickly, about a book we'll be talking about a lot over the course of the next year before it comes out, because my main man RG3 has apparently decided to write a tell-all book about his time with the Washington football team. And I have to admit, I cannot wait. Oh man, all of my childishness has been piqued by this one, boy. I cannot wait to get into that. So anyway, but let's get to the matter at hand, take a quick break here and I Mix What I Like and come back with the April Silver takeover part two. So don't go anywhere. Back in just
I mix what I like, what I like, what I like, what I like, what I like.
Oh boy. April Silver is back in the building and I don't know what's going on. It's another April Silver takeover. Welcome back, April.
Morning.
Welcome, Clarence, Dr. Green. Good to see you again. Welcome,
good
welcome.
Good morning.
April, what have you done? What is going on?
Yo, I must like being in the good company of, you know, Nana Camille used to say, good morning, shipmates. And Kabah, when you said good morning, heathens, Kabah. Brother Kabai, made me think of that thing that Nana Camille Yabro used to say, good morning, shipmates. So I must like being in the company of fellow Africans. Is that what it is?
It must be, although that greeting is traumatic for me. Shipmate just brings me back to that Navy captured sentence I suffered. It's a little traumatic, but I appreciate in the spirit it was offered here, I'm sure. So yes indeed.
Absolutely. Shout out to Nana Camille Yabro. I know your audience knows her and yes, loves indeed. Her.
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely.
As a matter of fact, Dr. Green's son quoted her in one of his songs way back. Right. And I interviewed her about that years ago, and she was very flattered by the shout out.
Yes, and she has a birthday coming up next month. Yep.
And quick, Dr. Green, just as a quick aside, we defended your son just in passing We didn't appreciate, not everybody appreciated Kanye's critiques of your son's skills. I thought that was a little bit of an unnecessary shot that Ye was taking, as he was taking shots literally on Drink Champs. So puns, yes. Anyway.
Yes, well, thank you for doing that. But you know, I thought it was really funny when one of the criticisms was that Talib reads too much. He's always sending me stuff. Yeah. Read this.
Yeah, read
this.
Kanye said, "I don't read." He was like, "I don't read. I have intuition." He said. I said, "I was like, that's deep. Okay, that's deep."
Well, you know, his name, you know, seeker of truth and knowledge. He definitely lives up to that.
Mm-hmm. Right on. Right on.
Yeah.
Yep. Anyway, April, please tell us who we have here. What's the plan for today?
Absolutely. Y'all know I got to talk fast because I always have amazing people, right, to share with your audience. So we have for the first 15 minutes, Dr. Brenda M. Green, who is returning from, she was with us with the first April Silver Takeover. So Dr. Green, welcome. Your audience might remember that she's the founder and executive director of the Center for Black Literature at Mega Evers College in Brooklyn, New York. And so we're bringing also with her the director. And so Clarence Reynolds, who's with us. And so I work there. My agency consults with the Center for Black Literature. So we're really happy to have them both. And the reason why I thought it was important, Jared and Kabah, because, you know, this whole notion of activism and how we use arts as a weapon or as a tool and advancing, you know, a better life for us, that is embedded in the work of John Oliver Killens. And so this is one of the literary giants who passed in the 60s. I don't remember what year, Dr. Green will correct me, but his legacy is important and it speaks to the National Black Writers Conference that's coming up, the Killens Review, and we just really wanna embrace all of the writers, all genres of writers, Black writers, and those who use their work to advance the culture and to fight against oppression. So that's the theme for this first 15 minutes. I don't know how we're going to do all of that in 15, but if anybody can handle that, it's Dr. Green and Clarence. So welcome to the both of you. How are you?
Thank you. Thank you so much, April. Thank you, Brother Ball. Thank you, Brother Kabar. And nice to see my partner here, Clarence Reynolds.
Good morning.
Really, good morning. It's really, really good to be here.
Yes. Well, I want you to jump right in, Dr. Green, if you would. Tell us why the work of John Oliver Killens. First, introduce who he is really briefly for those who might not know, and why his legacy as a Black activist writer is so important to the Center for Black Literature.
Right. Well, John Oliver Killens is a novelist, an essayist, and first and foremost, a literary activist. He had an influence on so many writers, people like Maya Angelou, Terry McMillan, Elizabeth Nunez. His vision was to really become involved in promoting justice and equality. And he actually started out as a lawyer. He ended up getting into writing. He worked with unions, and he ended up getting into writing a novel really after serving in World War II. He wrote one of his famous books is Then We Heard the Thunder, which is a critique of what happened to Blacks in World War II. What happened to Blacks in World War II. He also did Youngblood, one of his, which is kind of based on growing up in Georgia and the racism he encountered. He did The Cotillion, which is a satire. He's an excellent satirist. His most recent is The Minister Primarily, which is a satire based on what happens when minerals are found in a country that is not real, but what happens between Africans and the colonialism and the grab for politics. He also was the writer in residence at Mega Evers College. Before that, he was the founder of many conferences. He worked at Fisk University, at Howard University. When he was at Mega Evers College, he decided to embark on one of his visions, which was to hold a National Black Writers Conference every year. And that National Black Writers Conference began in 1986. We were not able to hold the conference every year. We hold it every 5 years. And that happened until 2000 when I founded the Center for Black Literature. So John Oliver Killens embodies the activism that has been used to bring writers together. He was the type of man that could pick up the phone when he wanted to have a conference and gather writers, and they would all come to him and participate in conferences. So we celebrate John Oliver Killens. We do it through a variety of programs, which include our Killens reading series, our Killens review of arts and letters. And also we also make sure and acknowledge him whenever we have the writers conference, because that was his vision. And whenever we hold the conference, one of the things I say is, you know, John Oliver Killens will be smiling because he was memorialized in the work we do at the Center for Black Literature.
Absolutely. That's a really great introduction. We appreciate it. I know when I was a student at Howard, we studied his work and his call for the Black aesthetic, as was the narrative of the day. So we thank you for that. And when you're not speaking, I'm going to ask you to put your phone on mute, whoever, Dr. Green or Clarence, when you're not speaking.
I muted her for, people just are calling. They clearly don't understand what she's involved with right now and have the nerve to think that they can reach her during this important discussion. But anyway. Dr. Green, I muted you. Sorry. Go ahead. Thanks.
No, I was saying my cell phone was on mute. It was my other phone that I forgot to. That's my fault. So I apologize for that.
No, you're so popular and so well respected. People just want to talk to you at 8 o'clock in the morning on a Friday.
She had to. It was the bat phone. She was.
Yes.
You got to leave one line open.
How many people still have that phone? Yeah. Landline.
Yes. Clarence, so why don't you round it out for us? Because as the director at the Center for Black Literature, again, shout out to Mega Evers College. We have our first Black woman president there at Mega Evers College in Brooklyn, Dr. Patricia Ramsey. So shout out to her and her administration. They're less than 6 months in. But here you are, Clarence, as the director, and your primary oversight is literary programs, but you're also the editor-in-chief of the Killens Review, which again is dedicated to the memory of John Oliver Killens. So tell us about the Killens Review that's coming out. Please make sure you shout out the Black Publishing Company, where we got it produced and where it's going to be sold, because we Black like 360. So take it away, Clarence, on that note.
Thank you, April, and good morning. And thank you, Jared and Brother Kaba. And good morning again, Dr. Green. It's good to see everybody. Yes, I'm really delighted to be a part of the Center for Black Literature, and particularly with promoting the John Oliver Killens Reading Series program, which takes place every Thursday, the second Thursday of every month. And also the Killens Review of Arts and Letters, which is our biannual literary journal. And Dr. Green had talked about John Oliver Killens, and to make it very short, I first moved to New York many years ago, and the first thing I did was join the Harlem Writers Guild, the Harlem Writers Workshop, Frederick Douglass Writers Workshop, and one of my first instructors was Arthur Flowers. Now, I moved here with this intention of being a novelist. That didn't happen. But Arthur Flowers was one of my instructors, and he talked about John Oliver Killens. So I was so influenced by the things he said about what John Oliver Killens taught him that for me, it comes full circle to be a part of programming now that incorporates John Oliver Killens' vision and his work. Also, just to note, John Oliver Killens was nominated for 2 Pulitzer Prizes. His novels were nominated for 2 Pulitzer Prizes. So I know one of them was And Then We Heard the Thunder. But I don't remember right offhand, but I do know that he was noted for those books, his fiction. But the John Oliver Killens reading, let's talk about the literary journal, because the new version is out now. You can purchase it at AfricanAmericanLiteratureBookClub.com. It's entitled The Beautiful Struggle. And I want to thank Paul Coates of Classic Black Classic Press, who printed the program, the journal for us. It's beautiful. It's absolutely beautiful. And I'm excited about the content as well. But the first John Oliver Killen's reading literary journal was published in 2010. And it was launched during the 10th National Black Writers Conference. And since then, we've hosted, we produced it, we try to produce it twice a year. It comes out in the fall and winter, and then spring and summer. And over the years, we've included writers such as Quincy Troup. We've included Patricia Jones Spears, Donna Hill. We've had excerpts from J.M. Holmes. And then not only do we promote the works of established writers, as John Oliver Killen would have done, we wanted to engage new writers and introduce the audience to readers, to up and coming writers whose voices may not be read anyplace else. And so with that, I'm really excited about it because we were able to reach out to new writers and then to new readers. Readers are reading things that people just give them all the time, or you go to Kirkus Books Reviews or some of those other places that say, these are the books you ought to read. But we are proud to have a lot of the writers in our journal who may not get that attention in other places. And for example, I printed it out this morning. There was a young man who lived, his name is Disho Dashi. Pardon me for screwing up his name, but he's a genocide survivor from the Congo. And he now lives in South Africa. And he actually sent me a letter. He said, I approached many people in the past to help me publish without, and it's been without success. The short story was edited twice and submitted without success. This year, I submitted my version to many publishers and agents. You are the first one to give me a positive feedback. Thank you so much for doing that. And this man, his short story is amazing, and it's in one of our earlier issues of the Killen's Review of Arts and Letters. But the main thing that I wanted to bring home is that we're all about just letting writers be in their own skin, so to speak, and write about the things that are important to us as a Black community, and how the Black experience is so rich and so complex, and how it's different for every writer. But all the readers need to read these things as well. And I'm really happy too about on one of our last issue, at the crossroads, the photographer whose image is on the cover, Rachel Eliza Griffith, people know her mostly. She just recently won the Hurston Wright Legacy Award for Poetry, but a lot of people may not know her that she's also a fantastic photographer. So she also sent me a letter saying that she was so happy to have her work grace the cover of the Killen's Review. And this issue of the Killen's Review, I'm so delighted we have, the cover is the artwork of the legendary artist, Otto Niels, and it's absolutely beautiful. So all I can say is get a copy. You can go to ALBC.com, purchase a copy of the Killen's Review, and support the Center for Black Literature. You can go to our website and find out about some of our upcoming programs. And also connected with John Oliver Killen's is our John Oliver Killen's reading series, where we bring in writers from every genre that we can imagine or that's imaginable or that's out there. And we have a program, an hour-long program every month throughout the year, where these writers talk about their new books, they talk about the craft of writing, they talk about their experiences of their journey to becoming a writer, and then how what goes on around them or what goes on in the world impacts and affects their writing. And it's always a lively program. So the next program is going to be December the 9th. And I'm really happy because I'm already thinking about what I need to do for next year. But the next program is December the 9th. And we're delighted to have honoree Fanon Jeffers about her new book, The Love Songs of W.E.B. Du Bois. And she's going to be in conversation with our one and only Dr. Brenda Green. So I'm hoping that everyone will go to visit our website and tune in.
So Clarence, that you gave us the perfect way to close out this segment. The website is centerforblackliterature.org. I'll make sure I put it in the chat as well, but we'll push that. But you know, the event on December 9th with honoree Fanon Jeffers, purchasing the Killen's Review through a Black publishing company, which is the African American Literature Book Club, or AA lbc.com. Shout out to Troy Johnson.
Absolutely.
Shout out to Paul Coates over at Black Classic Press, who's produced the publication. So we thank you for letting the audience know live, and then, you know, moving forward, what the Center for Black Literature is all about and who we pay homage to, one of our great ancestors. Absolutely. The literary giant, John Oliver Killens. So we thank you. Dr. Green, you're on. Yeah.
I just wanted to say, just to make the point, John Oliver Killens died in 1987. Our first conference was in 1986. He died the year after our first conference, but we continued. So this is another reason that we want to make sure at the Center for Black Literature that he is at the core, his spirit is at the core of everything we do. And when I think about and listen to what you're doing here, Brother Ball, bringing together activists and artists and musicians and writers and talking about the intellectual life of our Black culture, it reminds me of the kind of work that John Oliver Killens would have been doing. He was a writer, but he was also into bringing everyone together and making sure that all people in the arts and activism supported each other. The embodiment of what April does in the Akilo Work songs. So I just wanted to add that.
Thank right you, Dr. On. Green.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you so much.
Closing that out.
Okay.
Shout out to you so much for having us.
Thank you.
To the Killens
Anytime.
Family.
Anytime. Thank you. Right on. Good. Thank you both very much.
You know, I first heard about Killens, man. Actually, you know, many of us came into this thing, this consciousness, this blackness through Malcolm X. And I can remember him talking about the writers, you know, Killens and all these other people. And I was like, so that just led me. I was like, well, if Malcolm X is reading this guy, I got to check out his work. And I'm glad I did. So he's somebody you want to check out his work. He was a brilliant writer.
Absolutely. And similarly, I came to him through John Henry Clarke, and particularly writers respond to William Styron's Nat Turner collection. Yes. And then from there went on. So Killens was right on and sharp as they come, and definitely worthy of this kind of commemoration and remembrance. So we definitely appreciate the work of Dr. Green and Brother Reynolds, for sure. Yes, indeed.
Yeah, I'm excited about the opportunity. So it's always good to be here. I know we have, I'm about to check my text. I hope I don't have no bad news. I know we're going
I was just letting you know, Jam is backstage. If that's who you're looking for, yeah. And if you're ready, we can.
Well, actually, we can I was looking for, you brought him on. I was looking for LaFrances Rogers Rose. We wanted to go in with that if she's backstage.
She's not, amazing. Unfortunately.
Okay.
She is not. So, and wait. Nope. Erica England.
Well, Jam and Erica were going to come on together because that update on Howard University. But if we don't have Dr. Rogers Rose, and then we can just flip it and go with Jam and Erica. So you know, I'll follow your lead on that, Jared.
Jam,
we're black. Brother, we're black. We always love the jam. We always love.
Yeah.
There we go. There we go.
We always ready to jam, or at least put some jam on some mama's biscuits or something like that.
There's the tie-in.
As long as it ain't jelly.
There you go. Because ain't nothing better than
exactly.
Jam, unfortunately, brother, you've been just dragged into a running joke about my former funk band, which was titled, which was named Mama's Biscuits. And as I like to remind you, the greatest funk band in Western Maryland between 1997 and 1999.
In Western Maryland,
at Frostburg State. Not all of us had the pleasure and privilege of making it to the illustrious Howard University. So while we were out there in the hinterlands, at Frostburg State University.
Don't start.
No, that's what I'm saying. Anyway.
Where's my
battles? When Erica, I don't see her on camera yet. When she pops up on camera, I'll bring her up when she's ready to go. But so forgive me, but perhaps we can get started with Jam and at least start hearing from him. And then when Erica's ready, we can add her to the mix.
Absolutely.
Again, puns intended.
So what I wanted to do with the segment on Howard and the Blackburn takeover, because Jerry, you remember I had wanted to bring on one of the student protesters for some time. You know, we talked about that. So this was the time that it could actually work and line up and, you know, align with the universe. So I wanted the audience to know what happened, you know, like in a nutshell, right? Like what happened? What was the resolve? What's going forward, you know, from the student protest leader, one of the 8 women student protest leaders, and then Jam, who's an alum of Howard. I wanted him to give the perspective that he did, because he'll tell you, you know, we were both in Black Near Force together. And so we have a brother sister relationship. But when we're embattled, you know, that flips. And so I had to put him on assignment, and he went down for 2 days and turned out to be there for 2 weeks, like on the ground, like for 2 weeks with the students, in the way him and Dr. Steve Jackson, who's another alum, in a way that just reshaped how we were going to move, how the students were going to be protected and such. So, and there's Erica. Here we go. So,
hi.
Hey, Erica, how you doing?
Good. How are you?
Looking amazing.
Love the gay lay. Love the gay lay.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes.
Gave it to me.
Say it again, Erica.
I said one of my aunties gave it to me.
Yes. Yes. Your aunties from where?
Sierra Leone.
If I was, you know, I had to bring that up. Erica's family is from Sierra Leone. I know she'll talk about that, but I just found out from AfricanAncestry.com that on my mother's side, we come from the Mende people in Sierra Leone. So she and I have a lot of connections.
hey, Mr. Jam.
What's up?
So if I may,
they had to grow a lot of rice Erica, here in America.
What'd you say? Right.
I said they had to grow a lot of rice. There's a lot of Sierra Leoneans, you know, people of that ancestry here, because they needed to grow that rice down there in South Carolina.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes, mm-hmm. Absolutely. So, Erica, like real quick, because we do have another guest coming on after you and Jam. But can you, in a nutshell, let the audience know, because this audience has been totally involved and engaged and supportive, you know, energetically, spiritually, politically with the Blackburn takeover. And I introduced you as one of the many young woman leaders, you know, of that takeover, where you all were occupying the student center. You're out now. So can you give us a quick what happened from your student protest position? And then Jam, I'll turn it over to you to, you know, because you have an interesting role that you play. So, Erica?
Yes. Yeah, so, let me know if you can hear any background noise. I think my neighbor has decided to blow leaves.
we got you.
Okay. So, you said specifically to like what happened and then like the aftermath?
Yes.
So, essentially, like how the takeover unfolded, there were a lot of issues that were going on in the semester, even, you know, before the semester started. The school was trying to drive their own narrative on like that things were not as bad as students were making them out to be. It really wasn't the case. Even before school started, students were having issues like getting through to administration, you know, finding housing. There were students that showed up who were told they had housing and then were turned away and had to find, you know, other options. There were two smaller protests that happened before this larger protest happened. So things have been building for a while, which is why I don't understand why administration acted as if they were completely blindsided that this happened. So then there was an evening where student government, HUSA, put on a town hall. They had worked with administration to try to find, you know, a good date, because they said, you know, you guys need to be able to talk to students about all the issues that we've had this semester. There's been so many. And none of the administration showed up. And at that point, it's like, okay, they're really not trying to hear us, especially since we had had our seats removed off the board during the summer. So it's like, we don't have this voice on the board that we once had that can like make sure that students are taken care of. And then when we're trying to find other avenues to speak to administration directly, they're not showing up. So the protest started that night. And that night, after I guess word got back to administration that we were doing a building takeover, all of a sudden a handful of administration showed up with the police. But from there, we were inside for 33 days. A lot happened in that 33 days. Emotionally, mentally, things were really rough. But in the end, we finally came to an agreement with administration, one that really could have happened many, many days earlier, had administration really like sat down to hear, you know, what was on our mind and some of the issues that we were going through. I kept saying this many times before, but, you know, you can't really understand what it is like to be a student in COVID in 2021 and make decisions for students when you're not a student.
And one of the things that you all drove home, I thought very well, was that your demands were not demanding, right? That was a narrative that you all had put up there, you know, put out there a lot. You know, this issue around shared governance and being disenfranchised from the Board of Trustees, the housing situation, and just to be heard and to make sure that a peaceful protest would not result in retaliation. Like that kind of sums up essentially, yes, would you say what you all were looking for?
Yeah, it was a peaceful protest on our end. There were things that happened that even before an agreement was reached that felt like retaliation from the administration. So we knew we couldn't leave the building unless we had some kind of an agreement with administration. There was no way we could leave.
Right. Right. Let me segue into Jim. I know we're you know, going over a little bit, but it, you know, hopefully that's okay. But Jim, so you tell us how you got there.
Yeah.
Before you do that, tell us where you were 30 something years ago as a student walking in some of the, you know, in some of the same spaces intellectually where these students were today. First, give us that background. Jim.
All right. Well, first, greetings, everyone. How are you guys doing? Good morning. All that good stuff. So in 89, I was a student at Howard and a member of Black NEA Force, Force Freedom Organization for Racial and Cultural Enlightenment. Black, obviously, for us, the people in NEA. And I was integral to the security arm of our organization, which is one thing that set us apart from other organizations, that we actually had a real security arm where we actually trained, exercised, self-defense, et cetera, et cetera. And I was one of the people to help set up, and I want to stress that I was one of the people that helped set up security and going in and actually taking over the A building, you know, telling people, whoa, I'm sorry, telling grown people to leave their offices at early in the morning, that we were taking over the building and they had to exit.
This is 1989.
Correct.
Yeah.
You know, and so, yeah. And I was one of the guys that was one of the point people organizing and running the security for the organization.
So how did you end up in 2021?
Is it? There we go. Well, we always keep our ear to the ground in terms of what's going on. Huh? I'm sorry. Oh, we always bring our ears to the ground. What's going on? We've been involved in advising some of the past student protests, and when this one took off, you know, it was a lot of conversation amongst numerous alum about how we can support the students, how we can help. Myself and brother Steve, we both had the same desire. Let's go down there. Let's see what's happening. Let's identify what's going on, and let's see where we can most capably help them and assist them in fighting for it. Because it's ridiculous that in 89, we were fighting a board of trustee issue. And then now fast forward in 2021, they're fighting a board of trustee issue. Some of our issues was housing. Their issues are still housing, you know, and the petty presidents that have taken over the university that become very conservative as time pushes on, they become more and more conservative. They give in to the outside forces that are always pushing in on Howard University. They end up succumbing to those things, you know. And so myself and brother Steve, we went down, you know, basically on an assignment with support of other alum to go down there, give a little stress test. Let's see where the students are lacking. Let's give them some advice, help them. And let's make it very clear to them that the comfort of social media, the comfort of the press will not prevent the university presidents, as the one did in 89, from sending the police in to attack and to move them out forcefully. You know, in 89, President Cheek literally called one of his buddies, a frat brother, who was like number three in charge in the police department, and got the SWAT team in place at Howard, including of helicopters, coming to put troops on the roof, battering rams coming through doors, and Georgia Avenue littered with buses to arrest us. And I wanted them to be clear that just because cameras are there, we had all the press in the world, that they will still come in here and get you. You know, and then those 2 days, you know, we found some points that needed some shoring up. And so those 2 days ended up staying into 12 days. We were out there sleeping in some of the tents. We had set up like a little alumni area to support. We slept in tents on campus. Former faculty, current faculty, alum, former employees of the university joined us out there and slept out overnight. The gentleman who was the director of the building manager for the Blackburn Center for 20 years, Keith Jenkins, joined us as well in support of the students. And so we had various people coming in from New York, New Jersey, Maryland, Virginia, that came in different nights to support the students and stay out there.
You know, the reason why I wanted to put you and Erica together, because I think it's important to show that continuity between current students in 2021 and alum for 30 something years ago. And so this is, like we've said throughout the whole thing, that this is about Howard, and in some ways it's just not, you know, about Howard. It's Howard is a microcosm of this struggle, you know, that is embedded. When Black people get together and have different ways of how to design the world and how to design our relationships and how do we relate. And, you know, we are, what we say all the time is that there are always at least two Howards, and people think the shiny glossy version, but they don't know, many people might not know, and our job is to tell the whole truth about the ugliness, you know, of the university as well. And I think the last time I was here, Brother Jarrett and Brother Kabah, somebody was like, well, if all of this stuff is going on, like how is it that you still love the university? You know, we get that question a lot because we're fighting.
Yes.
And against the university, and people are like, well, you know, well, what's the point? And so it was Sonia Sanchez, I always remind people, that taught us we're fighting because we love the university, we love Black people, and you know, we can be embattled and still love. So you know, we have plenty of reasons to tap into that. But my last point, and Erica, I want to turn it back over to you. This is a little bit of a new thing. So that I just learned from Dr. Timothy Jenkins, one of the founders of SNCC, who was a part of Howard Alumni United. He reminded us just the other day, you were on the call, Erica, I'm sorry, to the alumni, he reminded us that literally the buildings on campus at Howard University were built by students and faculty. Were you on the call when he talked about that? Yes. I think maybe you both were. And so what Erica, I'm asking you for your thoughts as a young woman, a young student who we're very proud of. What does that mean? Well, how did that resonate with you when he talked about literally the buildings on campus were put brick by brick and during the founding in 1867 was done by students and faculty? What how did that land with you?
It was amazing to hear, but I wasn't surprised to hear it. To your point, going back to you know, people saying that we were embarrassing the school and like, how do you still want to be here? I compare my relationship to Howard as like a romantic relationship. Like, you fight for what you love. It's like, you're going to keep fighting for this relationship that you care about, that you really want to work, that you want to succeed. So it's not surprising to me that faculty, students and alumni as well, like, built buildings. Even if you walk down towards the administration building, the social work building, when you walk down the path towards the front door of the social work building, you can see, you look down in the bricks and you can see all of these names carved into the bricks in the pathway that leads into the building, showing all the people that were there that contributed to the school. So that's not surprising to me.
I'm with you, and we just want to lift you up, you and all the other students, the young women, leaders, yourself and others, for the courageousness. We know that this was life altering. You know what I mean? You all have effectively changed the DNA at the university and have been a model of perseverance and not giving up. So I just wanted to take the time to honor you. Can I jump in real quick? Yeah, please.
Yeah, Erica, I did want to ask, first of all, I appreciate you and Jam coming on, of course, and appreciate the struggle you all have been engaged in. But just two questions quickly. Could you, again, sort of summarize for us where things stand right now? What is the current state of everything? And then separately, I did want to ask, because a lot of from the outside looking in, a lot of the question and the discussion was with all of the recent and already existing prominently hired names and faculty who have been brought to Howard recently. Nicole Hannah Jones, Ta-Nehisi Coates, you know, like, and then even when you know, anyway, like, what has their relationship to this struggle been? So where are we now? And then the sort of prominent names that have gotten a lot of attention nationally, where have they been on all of this?
So I'll start with your first question, where we are now. The agreement that we reached with the administration is confidential. I can say that anything that was agreed upon will be forthcoming. And I'll also say that even apart from the agreement, there were things that happened that we consider a win before the protest was even over and as the protest started. So for example, there was no hypercare that the administration has called it, to where they were going into the dorms and examining all of the rooms, making sure that students knew the protocol to report things, that the issues of the mold, pipes bursting. It's not perfect, There were students who had reported things even after that process had started that were still having issues. You know, maintenance people coming in, looking at something, leaving, and then a week later, a pipe bursts after, you know, a student had reported that there was a leak. So it's not perfect, but we know that there has been increased scrutiny and there are more eyes now on what's going on. And that effectively rippled out into all of the stakeholders, the real stakeholders of Howard University. I know faculty right now are in a fight for their lives and livelihood, quite literally, you know, trying to come to an agreement with the school around, you know, equal or fair pay and fair wages and fair treatment from the administration as the esteemed educators and faculty that they are. So we see how there is a connectivity between all of the stakeholders at Howard. And I would say that the protest has heightened like the issues that everyone is facing. It was a student protest, and I want to make that very clear because I've heard, you know, different chatter about like what our intentions were. It was a student protest. We are the ones that are going to class with little to no Wi-Fi at times, or, you know, dealing with mold in the rooms, or dealing with a housing lack, which was highlighted in emails from the administration at the beginning of the semester. So again, I don't know why they were saying that there is no issues with housing. There were very, very clearly emails that went out at the beginning of the semester highlighting that there was a limit on housing. But all of those things combined, there were things.
Uh-oh.
I think she froze.
Yeah, okay, yep. I think she froze.
Okay. Well, she did say it was bad Wi-Fi. Yeah.
I wanted to add one thing. We have to be very careful in examining and looking at the contracts that are being signed on Howard's behalf and be very clear about the attacks to move the Board of Trustees. In 89, they bought Lee Harvey Atwater, who was the head of the Republican National Party, and they were trying to install him on the Board of Trustees. And now you fast forward, and we look back and we see Lee Atwater's cronies, his partners, the Trident of Evil, was Lee Atwater, Paul Manafort, and Roger Stone. That was then, and back in the late 80s, right? And there were so many students and various people who said, oh, give them a chance. But we see how those guys went. We see where they went. You have to be very clear. When your student leaders speak up, they're seeing and feeling things that maybe the masses may not get at the time. But then when you look at it later on in retrospect, like the deal that the Corvius deal, the dormitory, the pipe burst during the protests, the newest dormitories built on Howard's campus, two pipes burst during the protest, flooding two floors, where that dormitory would not allow that, the developers would not allow that dormitory to be named after a Black person historically, unless said Black person's estate ponied up naming fees, which is insane. You think at Howard University, so you have dorms named College South and College North. They could not be named after Black people unless the developers got money out of our historical Black people. Mm. We have to be very clear to watch these contracts. Wayne Frederick is doing some really, really poor business deals that are bad for the university long term.
This is
good for somebody else, somebody's pockets in particular, though. Because sometimes that's, you know, somebody gets a little something under the table. I mean, I don't know that. I'm not making an accusation. I'm just asking the question. And then I had a really quick question real quick. Because
But just quickly, Kabab, real quick. Kabab, hold on a second. Okay. Because Erica, I don't think she got a chance to finish. I would like to hear her respond to specifically to the question about the bigger names and their involvement. Or relationship to this, because I know that has gotten a lot of attention and discussion from those of us outside of Howard. So that, Erica, and anything else that you were attempting to finish, could you please do if you can?
Can you hear me okay? Mm-hmm. Okay. As far as the bigger names at Howard, I don't think, from what I can tell, I don't think maybe they were willing or able to speak up. I think they know, you know, some of the issues that were going on. One of the people you mentioned was a student at Howard. I'm sure he has experienced some of what we were talking about, because as I mentioned before, these issues were generational. I remember an article from the Hilltop newspaper in 2001, but before I was ever a student at Howard, highlighting a housing shortage, highlighting issues with mold growth on the walls. So these issues are not something that just like came out of the blue. That we've been dealing with them 20, 30, 40 years.
50.
Yeah. So they're not new issues. I think until I just thought, and maybe that was some naivety on my part, that, you know, we just had a protest of students in 2018 who took over the administration building. And I never for one second thought that that protest would last for 33 days. I thought, okay, administration just had a protest in 2018. A lot of issues are still going unresolved. We're also having to deal with another issue surrounding COVID. Like, they're going to have some grace and the foresight to say, okay, we're going to come to the table quickly with these students and resolve that. I was shocked that it did not end before a week. I think it was a missed opportunity for
the world was
alumni. It was a missed opportunity to, you know, do the right thing quickly. And it was a missed opportunity for some of the bigger names and the more well-known alumni to come forward, because they know that we weren't making things up. The faculty knows we were not being we're not exaggerating. The things that we were talking about were happening.
And did you all, were you all the ones who invited Jesse Jackson? Was he invited? I know you're saying this wasn't a student protest per se, but was he invited by the organizers? How did?
Yes, he was invited. He reached, mm-hmm. He also, I think his staff reached out as well because they saw what was going on. And, everyone knows that Howard University has, you know, a very influential hand in the Black community. I've heard many times before people say, as Howard goes, you know, the rest of the HBCU community will go. And to that point,
well, they would surely like to think that, but some of us have.
I was about to say, come on now. We were with you up until that point. Now you're doing too much.
After Howard started theirs, it's just that theirs seemed to.
Young lady.
Yes, it just seemed that their protests at these other HBCUs that happened like shortly after Howard started, they had their demands met and got to meet with their presidents and boards fairly quickly compared to Howard. I don't know what this strong hand Howard was trying to show was about, but it shouldn't be about that. It should be about, you know, coming to the table and talking these things out and resolving them quickly. Because nothing that we were saying was exaggeratory. Nothing we were saying or asking for was demanding. They were very basic things. Like, we want to have, you know, safe and clean housing. We want to have a say in what happens to us on campus, on the board. We want to be able to talk freely with our administration. Universities everywhere have town halls. There was nothing that was... we weren't asking for Olympic-sized swimming pools in the dorms. It was nothing like that.
Heated floors.
I want to ask real quick, and I know this is probably a rhetorical question, but I got to ask it just to put it on the record, you know, because I noticed when I was in school, the football team, they had their own dorms, and they even had their own cafeteria, like they, you know, at Hampton University, by the way, but we're not gonna get into that. I'm just making a point. I'm curious to, yes, much higher on a higher level.
Correct? No, Hampton Institute.
We're not gonna start. We're gonna put the top back on the jam and screw it, put it back in the refrigerator. All right, so but my point is that the football teams tend to get priority because they bring in money and all that stuff. Did the football teams' dorms have these issues as well? As
let me answer that. As a coach, I'm a track and field coach, and I put students into Howard on a regular basis. I have two students at Howard currently who are running on the track team. The NCAA changed that. They're no longer allowed to have athlete-only dorms because it created a second-class citizenship of students. And absolutely. So they cannot, no dorm can have more than 50% athletes in it now. That's an NCAA policy. But it used to be that way. Mm.
But were football players affected though in this situation? Were they affected, you know, disproportionately, or how did that work out in this situation? I don't know if anybody knows that for sure.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't want to speak to the athlete experience because I'm not a student athlete on campus. I will say that I know that there were part of all of the athletic teams that were supporting us. I think the administration did a very good job of not even just with the athletes, but other student groups on campus, including, the Divine Nine, threatening different things surrounding maybe expulsion. I mean, the very first night we were inside, we were threatened with expulsion and also arrests. So I think they did a very good job of like fear mongering students that were connected to the school in that way about supporting the protest. But I know that they're dealing with the same lack of Wi-Fi connections when they're trying to do classwork as well. They're dealing with some of the same issues in the dorms. So as I mentioned before, whether people spoke up or not, they know that the issues that we were talking about on campus weren't just fabricated. They didn't just come out of thin air because we're all dealing with the same thing.
Shared,
whether you're an athlete,
shared governance affects everyone. Or not.
Exactly. Exactly.
Mm. Yeah. Mm.
Well, yeah. Sorry. Go ahead, April.
Mm. No. I just wanted to thank you for letting us go over. I'm cool with whatever, but I want to definitely give some shout outs at the appropriate time because we know that this is such an important show and an important audience. I need your audience to know like some key people that, you know, represent the unity that happened. You know what I mean? So, if you want me to do that now or you had another question,
sure. Go ahead. No, that's yeah, it. I'm good. Go ahead. Yeah.
Okay, I wanted to shout out my brother, our brother, Mayor Raz Baraka, mayor of the city of Newark, who's a Howard alum, who is the son of Amiri and Amina Baraka. And I called him to debrief him on a deeper level. He was aware of what was going on somewhere around Midway. And I debriefed him on a deeper level and without hesitation. You know, he came and spoke to one of our alumni meetings and then within a week was there on campus and played a significant role. The president of the university, when he found out that Mayor Baraka was coming to campus and invited him to come and speak, and Mayor Baraka played a significant role in helping to bring this to some closure. He said from day one that the students will be there for that long is dangerous. You know, and he compared the president of the university in 1889 that we stood up against, Dr. James E. Cheek, compared him to the current president, Dr. Wayne Frederick, and just helped to crystallize a number of things. So I just needed to shout him out for his diplomacy and the role that he played and how he loves the students and told them that you absolutely have a right to protest. I wanted to shout out Howard Alumni United, the organization that I'm with, and Donald Temple, Dean Keene, Damani Keene, who was an administrator at Howard University. And because we talked about the 2018 protest that Erica mentioned, I wanted to shout out HU Resist as well. And the faculty played a significant role. Of course, you know, one of your regulars, Dr. Brett Carr. Yeah, no, they were, I had them on the list too, the capstone group, but was doing the faculty to say Dr. Greg Carr, Dr. Marcus Alfred, Dr.
Anthony Jackson.
Yep, he was on the list. Dr. Eric Walters as well, the faculty senate, and the non-tenured faculty at Howard. You know, those who don't have tenure and some of those who are still waiting to get paid. You know, the faculty came out in a very significant way to say enough is enough. You know what I mean? So we want to shout them out because that's a lot of bravery when your checks are on the line or your checks to come, you know, still haven't made it through the system. And Dr. Josh Myers, who, you know, who I know is a friend of the show, you know, as well. And last but not least, Dr. Steve Jackson, another alum who was with JAM.
My brother Steve.
On the ground, you know, just making sure that the students were safe, bringing context. So just for the record, just because we are the people who read and study and people are going to come back and watch this, people need to know those names. And there are so many others. But at the very least, those names. Shout out to Cherie Warren as well, the little general, we call her, from Black Near Force as well, who came down. And just because we always got to shout out Miss Roberta McLeod, who's the mother to all of us at Howard University. So just wanted to do that in the spirit of, and the parents, I'm sorry, the parents who came to campus as well. So Jared, I'm always appreciative of you giving us an opportunity to cement this activism work. And
Brother if I Cooper. May, I would also like to, I would also like to highlight and shout out again, Mr. Donald Temple, who from one of the very first police encounters at the beginning of the protests where a student and an officer had put his hands on a student, one of the female student protesters, I gave him a call and he was right there from that point on to make sure that we were protected. Make sure that he helped to get us an agreement with the school and to keep us safe. Because after that, we weren't, to your point from like what's happened back in the day, and I know the history, we weren't sure that we were going to be safe. He stayed with us through the process in that way and helped us come out safely. And I will always be indebted to him for that. He saw all of the background, all the good, bad, and the ugly. Even saw me had a whole a breakdown after the second meeting we had with the university's lawyers. So I appreciate him for being there through all of it.
Well, one more person I want to throw out. One more person, I'm sorry. I want to give a shout out to Miss Maria Jones, yes. Mayor Razaraka's sister, because she coordinated the food and the food deliveries and literally fed that building for all them days.
Yes, she did.
No.
And people don't know, but even before the larger protest in Blackburn, she was assisting her and the capstone group. We're assisting student groups even before that were like trying to talk to administration, you know, get some issues resolved. And she was very pivotal piece of this with assisting students in anything that we need. Anytime we called her, she was right there. I would also like to give a shout out to, why is it slipping my mind? The bookstore right down the street from Howard, Sankofa. I don't know why I couldn't remember for a second. Sankofa. I would also love to thank the ownership of Sankofa. They were there for us as well. Late night student meetings after they were supposed to have been closed, but we were still inside of Sankofa. Meeting, strategizing, you know, talking, learning, educating ourselves. So thank you to Sankofa as well.
Definitely. Right.
Listen, April, I like I've said, you're always welcome. Erica, Jam, same to you all, to this show, to this platform, even beyond this particular show. We welcome supporting these kinds of efforts and discussions. This is what we put it together for. So thank you all very much for the work you have done and are doing, and continued strength. And again, you're always welcome back. April, big appreciation to you once
again.
Thank you.
And maybe we'll come back with Dr. Rogers Rose. Obviously, there was some kind of glitch, but that's a pioneering Black sociologist that I would love for, you know, love to talk to her with you all.
Absolutely. So anyway, good people, we are going to keep it moving right for now. But again, you're always welcome back. And like always, as Fred Hampton said to you, we say peace because we know you're willing to fight for it. So peace to you all. And we'll be right back here with more I Mix What I Like and Black Power Media in just a minute. Peace. Take care.
I mix what I like, what I like, what I like, what I like.
All right, welcome back once again to I Mix What I Like here on Black Power Media. Brother Kabah, I'm Jared Ball. Big shout out again to April Silver and the part two of her Takeover series here, and all of her colleagues and comrades. We appreciate all of them and their work, and look forward to extend those conversations. But speaking of extending conversations, there are a number of things that I'd like us to get to before we get out of here this morning. And Brother Kabah, what is your time like? Because this, we might have to, I might at least need to run over a little bit. What is your time like this morning? You good? Okay. Now, I've been struggling with some tech issues, as I've been unfortunately having to report lately. So I've tried to set up a workaround for that issue. And hopefully that workaround will work. But one of the things, first of all, so folks might remember, like, I don't know if it was this year, last year, but there was what I've described as a political catfish experience that I've suffered, and I just got caught by this person again. Because this person on Instagram has two things that continue to confuse me about their approach and their identity. One is that they use the tag no name, and it has a blue check. So they're apparently an Instagram verified blue check, whatever, and they use the name no name. So when I get a message from this person, not that it happens or has happened often, but I keep thinking it's the rapper No Name, who, you know, the MC activist artist from the West Coast doing her thing. And I thought that, so when I got this message, and particularly because of what was sent, which was a clip of Kwame Ture giving a lecture. And the person sends me this message saying, this sounds like exactly what you've been arguing for a long time, Brother Ball, Dr. Ball, whatever they were saying, right? So I was like, cool. I thanked the person. I'm saying, thank you. I said, you know, you should come on the show and walk us through this clip with us and all this other kind of stuff. And the person is responding, oh, I can't because I'm, you know, I'm in the hospital. So I'm like, oh man, get well. You know, I didn't know, and it turned out to be just, you know, nothing serious. But then I looked again and I said, and I clicked the name again and I said, and it's this dude who's like a rapper, but like you know, just a what I would consider a regular non-political MC, just doing a regular.
Was he a no-name rapper?
I guess so. I mean, he's got a following. There is a sizable audience. That's the other thing that was confusing. Like, the numbers are all there, so it presents like this would be her. And then because of the way the message came to me with all this familiarity about, you know, and I was like, wow. So, but nonetheless, I had to admit and thank the person, because I don't recall ever seeing, I certainly don't remember seeing Ture do this in this way. Or make this point. So I want to try to play this short clip. Now, I got to say the audio quality is horrible. There's some struggles with the mic he's wearing and the sounds it's creating. So we're not going to watch much of it. And I've already put the link in the show notes. But what he does here is to me essential. It's something I've been trying to argue as it relates to the issue of economics versus politics. So let's just check this out real quick here. From Howard University, so it's a perfect segue, 1972. Let's check this out.
We should be black businessmen. What we need, man, is, look here, man, we gotta have some money before we can do anything. Oh, brother, it's not money who creates man. It's man who creates money. Let me get the people. We'll make our money. I hear you.
Hold on, I missed a part. Hold on a minute. Do you all hear the echo, or is that me?
You must start politically. You can't start.
Okay, here we go. My bad. Sorry about that.
I hear some noise.
That before you can solve.
Yeah, the noise is, unfortunately, that's the part I'm talking about. I think it's his mic.
You must start politically. You can't start economically. Got a lot of people try and do that. They tell you we should be black businessmen. What we need, man, is, look here, man, we gotta have some money before we can do anything. No, brother, it's not money who creates man. It's man who creates money. Let me get the people. We'll make our money. I hear you.
He'll come back to the point in just a second. He's just answering this question.
Politically, what are you doing?
And he mentioned before that the audio quality is not great. So for those who might be just checking.
Right, yes. It is not good audio quality, but he's just answering this, coming to this question, then he'll come back to the point, and I think it's
well, after you have a thorough understanding of it, study it. I do it all the time. I'm pulling positives from negatives. I do those things all the time. Because theory without practice is empty. There's no discussion on this economics. Everybody agrees that you must first have political movement. You must understand now what you're agreeing with. You're saying that anybody who comes to us pushing a program of economic development or economic this or money this before pushing a program of political education is going the wrong way. That's what you're saying. Are you sure you agree with that? Well, what you're also saying is that once we start getting together, there ain't gonna be a lot of money. And we should not expect a lot of money. As a matter of fact, it's gonna get worse. As a matter of fact, it's gonna get worse. And what you're saying is that you're willing to put off economic satisfaction to meet your economic desires for the good of the political entity. That's what you're saying.
All right, I'm going to stop it there. Really, only because of the quality. But again, the link is in the show notes already, and I encourage people to watch really the whole thing. But the point that he's making, of course, is that, and he goes on to draw an analogy between a war horse and a race horse, and he's saying that we get caught up in the beauty and the speed of the race horse. Economically, where we're told to get our money right, to go set up our businesses and all of this. And what that ends up doing is it creates a class tension within our community, and it forces us to be pitted against one another, to struggle against one another for the speed of the individual collection or accumulation of relative wealth and income. Whereas opposed to the war horse, which is equally handsome, as he says, but moves much more slow, completing its task as it goes through its war, you know, and in other words, and not stopping its work until it has completed the full and complete entire task. So in other words, instead of rushing off for individual economic benefit, which claims to be working or beneficial to the community, to the collective, we should work collectively for the political power that is required, because as he says, if you have the people, you will have all the money that you need. And the way he does this, I think, is really beautiful. So I wish between the tech and the audio, we could really, you know, because there's too many other breaks and other things. So I would encourage people to just watch it. But what he really is doing, he's saying, better than I'm putting it, but making the same point that if you have an organized political movement and struggle and you assume political power, meaning you represent the people who produce the wealth that society chooses now through policy to redistribute to a 1% and create class tension and warfare, which would be the same at a microcosm within Black communities. He's saying if you have the political power, the wealth that is created, you have the people, you will have the money, because the money that the wealth we are all creating would be then through political power controlled by us, redistributed back to us. And then he makes even the more specific point of saying, rather than rushing off so individually, so and buying and getting my house and you getting your house, he's saying if you have political power, the community comes together and says, how many homes do we need? How many people need to be housed? And then you set upon a course to produce what is needed for the community, as opposed to having only focused on the individual and solely rushing off to accumulate what you can with the claim, as Jay-Z has made famous, how can I help the poor if I'm one of them? This idea, I have to get mine and then I can make corrective measures. That is exactly the opposite of what actually, how it works. So it was beautiful. I'm so glad that even in this political trolling or catfishing I'm suffering on whatever level, that this information was sent to me, or this particular lecture was sent, because that message from Ture, I think, could not be more important now than at any other point in history, or even during his time. We are inundated more and more, and I'm going to get to more of this in a minute, with this messaging of individual capitalist with the Black prefix on it, endeavor, with the claim that this is going to be beneficial to the community. And we're all the while we're being discouraged from what we really need to be doing, which is organizing into political movements to assume political power. Anyway. So, shout out to whoever this no name is, and for sending me this clip.
Yeah, I mean it's whoever the no name is, even if it's not no name, it's still somebody with the no name. So
there it is. So
yeah, anyway, you know I think we made this point several times before in terms of, you know, just what, but I think what people have to, you know, we just need a whole revolution in terms of what are economics, like what economics really is. And it's,
yes,
we're so caught up in the fiat currency model, which really takes you, it really deprives you of wealth, actually. because it takes it out of the source of what actually is wealth, actually is valuable, you know, and it puts us in a mindset where we have to chase something that is artificial and intermediary. But that's typically what happens, you know, with Western-based anything, is that they always present us with some kind of intermediary, whether it be political, whether it be economic, anything. It's always some kind of religious, you know, you need this in order to get to, you know, enlightenment. You need to go through this particular, right, you know, and it's always something that ultimately empowers them, you know, because they end up being in control of it, because they make us feel like we have to go outside of ourselves in order to get, you know, what we actually need, which is a great con.
Hey, I mean, so, and then to your point now, so, and I agree with you about the point about fiat currency. I agree with all that you said, but in general, in particular, this point about fiat currency, because I think the correct, and this again sort of gets to the point about what I think the this moment that we're in is reflective of, that there is this correct and justifiable criticism of fiat currency and its relationship to society and its impact on us. But what I think, just like I've been arguing elsewhere about why I think we're in this intense moment of, we can talk more than ever and more popularly than ever about many of the issues confronting us, but without the requisite level of sophistication and nuance and political education. So what starts with a legit criticism ends up being, you know, dragged off into something else. And this is another perfect example. So again, big shout out to Wise Intelligent, one of my favorite MCs, still one of the best doing it. But this is just another area where we don't fully agree. And we did have a little bit of a back and forth that I think relates to this. Is this new?
Because I know y'all went.
Yeah, this is new.
This is a new back and
this
forth.
This is new.
Because y'all had one before.
Yeah, now,
about the same thing.
As a fan, and I'm using that word intentionally, as a fan, I'm deeply appreciative that he will even engage. He has read my book. He is pop, you know, I love that he'll respond every once in a while to something I've, you know, put up in response, but that he doesn't, I can't get him to come on yet. We haven't got there yet, but I deeply appreciate it. But this is just another area where I think that righteous criticism, you know, gets into something else. So I saw that he posted this the other day on Instagram, where he says the IMF, the World Bank, the U.S. Department, I guess he meant the State Department of, no, the U.S. Department of Treasury, sorry, and now the Bank of England have publicly stressed their concerns about El Salvador's adoption of Bitcoin as legal tender. Their reaction was predictable for those of us who have read the Bitcoin white paper. Now, excuse me, a couple of things. One, I would want people to go back, and I'll put this in the show notes. excuse me. I would want people to go back and check the interview we did with Seb Solomon about crypto, Bitcoin, and data mining, the internationalization of this, its move into Latin America, the African continent,
the environment,
all of that. I would, you know, and I would like to, you know, look more closely at what is happening with El Salvador and Bitcoin being accepted as legal tender. In fact, the last thing I did see said showed that it obviously isn't helping, and many people aren't able to adopt or interested in adopting. It's not having the adoption rates, you know. But my point in here was that I went and read the white paper, the Bitcoin white paper, which people can easily find online. You could just Google Bitcoin white paper. It's 9 pages. It's written by the nominal founder of Bitcoin. And anyway, it's. But what I noted in it is that it just explains in a short 9 pages, I think,
what Bitcoin is, how blockchain is, you know, a summary of how blockchain is meant to work and provide the privacy. And it has some of the formulas in there trying to show how the private, you know, the privacy work. But my point in all of this was that it doesn't talk anything about how wealth is created, how wealth is distributed. It doesn't account for inequality. It doesn't account for poverty, and it doesn't account for political power that redistributes wealth to the top, the most elite among us. It also, so as I said here, that I was saying, of course, imperialists don't want interference with their hustle, but that doesn't mean crypto is helpful to the people. The white paper is wildly questionable and says nothing of what would end inequality or the extractive processes that create wealth. And eroding consumer protection, as does blockchain, is an anti-labor, anti-work, is anti-labor and anti-working people. Banks are not good, but the idea of regulated economies and consumer protection shouldn't be thrown out with them. Crypto is not political power, it's just another Ponzi investment bubble. Now, my point, so as I'm trying to draw this parallel from what Ture is saying to this, is that this is exactly what Ture was talking about. The claim that individuals—
Kwame Ture, not the social critic Ture, because just for people to clear on that, they might think you're talking about him.
Oh my God. Oh wow! I thank you. That didn't even cross my mind. So let me.
Yeah, I know.
Kwame Ture, formerly known as Stokely Carmichael. Good
Lord, yeah. You talk about investment. My wife used to tell me that I live in a bubble. I don't realize that other people don't think like the way I think.
No, you're right. I'm yes. Sometimes right on. Thank you for substance. That. Yeah. Wow. This is kind of threw me off. Yeah. No. Kwame Ture is because again the that's what I'm sorry that was the part I left out. The white paper does it talks about the blockchain technology, the formulas, the algorithms, the whatever that I don't understand when I look at them, and then it talks about this and what's attributed to it and is mentioned in the white paper is the importance of privacy and how it protects the seller primarily, and then to a lesser extent, the consumer. And my point is, I don't think that is the direction in which we would want to go in response to the current horrific situation. That is, I don't think we want unregulated, private, encrypted exchange where a consumer has no ability to check the person that they're buying from, has no recourse if something goes wrong. There's no federal, there's no regulatory oversight. There's no, there's all kinds of problems with that, that again, I think go against those who enter in these exchanges with an imbalance of power, that is poor people and working people and consumers that who do deserve protection. And there have been labor and consumer struggles to get consumers protected, better business bureaus and all this kind of stuff, so that there is some protection, so you don't have to worry about some anonymous fly-by-night seller coming through, lying to you, getting your money, and then dipping with leaving you with some harmful or destroyed product or you know, anyway. So that was one of the points that I was trying to make. And then of course also it is this claim that it by individual and investment in a speculative market, which is cryptocurrency, that this is somehow going to be beneficial for the collective is again returning us to the myth of that Kwame Ture was trying to get us to walk away from so many years ago. That is the quick, I'm gonna rush to go get some money, misses the point of the slow, methodical, all-encompassing, conquering move of assuming political power. That's what we are supposed to be doing, because as he said again, if you have the people, if you are organized with the people who produce the wealth, you don't need to worry about the so-called sort of individual pursuit that has been proven time and again not to be successful. Black capitalism is not an answer. So anyway, let me stop there and let you jump in if you have anything
No, I mean, the biggest thing for me that bothers me about all of this, really, ultimately, and a lot bothers me about it, but the biggest thing is the effect on the environment, you know, because again, you know, in keeping with capitalism, there are always going to be deleterious effects that are created by it. Like, it's not going to be, you're not going to get out of this unscathed, you know, and even if you believe in all of that stuff that it you know, whatever, the whole premise of it, of crypto. At the end of the day, you got to look at the environmental impact. You got to look at how you're going to sustain that, you know, with all of the data. Because the more we produce, the more waste we produce, the more radiation we produce, the more, you know, pollution we produce, which ultimately is going to kill the planet and ultimately us, you know, if we continue at the pace that we're talking about. So again, just as capitalism created all a myriad of social issues that sprang out of it, you know, dealing with, you know, keeping people deprived and keeping people from healthcare, keeping people from proper housing and education and on and on and on, the litany of things that we can point out, you know, ultimately that's exactly what's going to happen with this if it continues at the rate that people want it to go, because at the end of the day, you're going to have to be looking for a new planet, which is what some people may be doing right now.
Well, so in response, Wise Intelligent wrote back, it's about blockchain technology, distributed ledger, and private key cryptography, the foundation on which crypto is built. Understanding the white paper helps us understand why centralized banks are responding to the way they are. However, they are not the only industries blockchains are disrupting. We must look at the blockchain and decentralized applications as we look at the internet websites and web-based services. So again,
and we're against the banks, you know, and we understand that we need an alternate system, but this ain't it. That's the whole point.
And that's what I'm saying.
It's kind of like people who, you know, and this is maybe a little bit of a stretch, but like people don't like the Republicans. These are people who are not necessarily politically savvy. They don't like the Republicans, and so they go with something that's different, which apparently is different, which is the Democrats. Or they don't like the Democrats, so they go with something that's apparently, you know, different. So they go with but neither one of them is the answer. You know, the real answer is to have your own independent political system. And in this case, going back to Kwame Ture, you know, you need to have a political education and a political outlook, a political paradigm. And then that way we can actually better assess any of these issues that come up, you know, like this one, because if not, we'll end up getting sidetracked by something that gives us a little bit of truth. And so we go with that sometimes, but we forget the fact that there's some ultimate, you know, again, disparities that are going to take place that are going to disaffect us ultimately.
Yeah. So that, you know, there was some other respondents here. There was, you know, saying that we need to be involved with code, that we need to, you know, that like it says here, it's a reality along with capitalism, wealth gaps, inflation, petrodollars. If you feel like you've already engaged with the best minds on this topic, blockchain, to arrive at your conclusions, then so be it. We'll agree to disagree. But as I'm trying to just simply say again, first of all, I would love to discuss the white paper with Wise Intelligent or you know, anyone really, because it's not a political document. It's a short explanation of why blockchain and privacy is good, but good not in the sense of helping end poverty or inequality, but good in the sense of allowing people to transact privately. And then I think, I don't know if this was the intent by this individual who put this together, but it's certainly been attributed to this argument that this is a new area into which Black people can go technologically, code-wise, investment-wise, and benefit from. And obviously I just don't agree. So, there was a little bit, you know, like, anyway, so like I thought it was interesting. Like I follow you on YouTube and salute and respect you for featuring different views, especially economic myths in Tulsa. No doubt there are extremists on all sides of this issue who lack objectivity, math, technical reasoning, so on and so on and so on. But if DID verification platforms like LitenTree address blockchain, I'm trying to get to the voices who are technically aware of this are needed in
any balanced, objective discussion so we all walk away with more informed perspectives and don't immediately dismiss or embrace. And again, this is what I'm saying, like technology, it's for me at least, it's not about the specifics of any technology. It's about the broad historical recognition that technology doesn't change social relationships and it does not change in unequal relationships. It enhances them. So this is, again, I think part of the fundamental mythology here that we're only unfree and unequal because we lack a certain technology. And that's why I think, going back to Kwame Ture's comments from that video, that's why I think what we're lacking in today's analysis, in many cases, that a new technological setting, a new app, a new coin isn't going to change those relationships. What will change the relationships is assuming political power and being organized in such a way to do so. So, I'm honored that he would respond at all. I appreciate that he would, you know, and I appreciate that he takes his it's not celebrity per se, but he takes his earned space place in hip hop and Black people's, you know, lives, communities. He takes it seriously and he tries to make good use of it. So I definitely appreciate him for that. Even if, you know, we just happen to disagree here. But there's a little bit more on as it relates to this that I wanted to get to as well, because Yeah, go ahead.
Just a final note on Wise Intelligent. I was listening to some music on Shuffle the other day, and the song that Poor Righteous Teachers and the Fugees did came up, and I was like, oh, I forgot about this joint, man. That joint was hot.
Do you remember that joint?
One of the ones with Roz was oh yeah. Oh yeah, it's called Allies. It was on their second album, the New World Order. It came out in 96. Yeah, New World Order.
What were you about to say about Prize?
This is the Fugees. Now, I was going to say, even Prize had a dope verse on there.
There's the hate for Prize. Prize.
No hate. I gave him praise. I gave him praise.
That was sideways. That was sideways. Anyway.
I'm just saying, hate on Prize, and I'm just giving the band his props. Props to Prize.
Nah, man.
In that song. In that one song.
He had a lot of talent in it that he had to overcome in that group, man. So, you know, shout out to Prize, man.
It's kind of like not fair. Yeah.
So I got tagged on this thread by someone. I don't know this person, but I really enjoyed this thread. Someone tagged me on it because they saw it resonating with my own arguments. And it's around Bitcoin and financial tech and fintech. And if folks remember when Brother Kaba and I, weeks ago, when we were talking about Hill Harper and his promotion of crypto, he kept using fintech in his, you know, litany of fancy phrases and often repeated phrases as in the promotion of this. To sound sharp and slick and well versed in fintech or financial technology is sort of the subject of this here eventually, but just anyway, so just check out what Corey Doctorow does here on this thread, which I think is really important. The world's economy ground to a halt during the pandemic as millions died, production slowed or stopped altogether, and the resulting supply chain disruptions made many essential products, services impossible to deliver. All right. And yet the world's billionaires added $5.5 billion to their net worth during that time. Right on. Right. So he's saying we started with a pandemic, production slowed or stopped. I just want to highlight that. So everything slowed or stopped with disruptions made in many essential products and services. In the delivery of many essential products and services. And yet the world's billionaires added $5.5 billion to their net worth. All right. So as he continues, Thank financialization, the subordination of the real economy, the economy that makes and delivers the things we need, to the financial economy, a global high-stakes casino where wanton destruction of businesses and lives can be a path to unimaginable wealth and power. Financialization has infected every sector of our economy. No matter who you are, there's a casino game for you. But as with every casino, the only way to win is to own the casino, not to play the games. We're all proverbial suckers at the table. Take the investor class. They are piling into fintech startups, with 2021's fintech investments cresting $91.5 billion, more than double the eye-popping 2020 figure. What's fintech then? Writing for At Naked Capitalism, Satyajit Das, an ex-financier turned critic, calls fintech the untidy agglomeration of finance and technology. Das divides fintech into four buckets: payments, Stripe and Square, lending, including spectacular fraud of supply chain finance epitomized by Greenskill Capital. I don't know that particular example. Depositing, buy now, pay later, short-term loans, deposit taking online banking startups. When I read that, I heard Greenwood, the Greenwood Bank Initiative. And remember Killer Mike's Greenwood Bank that, as we've covered here previously, got $3 million from Jesse Williams, is that his name, the actor, and $40 million from JP Morgan to bring their total of investments to $43 million. allow the same simple formula, take a function, disguise it, toss a little jargon, financial engineering, technological disruption, I would add privacy, fintech, encryption, encrypted transactions, all this kind of stuff. Season generously with mystique, add some high profile spruikers of fawning media endorsements. Think again, Hill Harper, who else have we covered here? Jim Jones, Spike Lee, you know, in terms of the Black community's engagement with all of this. And then fintech uses some combination of the following eight tactics to transfer money from investors and users to the finance sector. Disguise the true function. For example, supply chain finance exploits disclosure rules so it can treat debts as accounts payable, disguising unsecured personal finance as a secure business, leading to spectacular losses. Mask the true economics. How do you make 20%, 26% APR look reasonable? Both supply chain finance manage it. They pay the seller immediately at 4% discount, then the buyer pays them back in installments over 2 months, 26% per year. Yes, this is borne by sellers, not buyers, but of course, sellers then charge more to cover it, so cash buyers end up subsidizing BNPL users. Find an attractive demographic. Supply chain finance and peer-to-peer lending prey on weaker borrowers who lack economic power and demand better deals. In this, i.e. Black people, for our purposes. Obviously, there's plenty of others who fit that category, including many, majority of white borrowers, in fact, but certainly Black people are targeted by this and preyed on as weaker borrowers. I want to skip ahead just a little bit because there is banking automation, investors sell products at a loss. There was a point that's financialization for traditional investors. But like I said, the casino's got a game for every player. As this person says, is consistently the best informed critic of Bitcoin and blockchain. In his essay, The Token Disconnect is a must read. Cryptocurrencies aren't currencies. They suck as stores of value. Unit, that's another one of the phrases. Units of account and units of exchange. Imagine if your house was denominated in Bitcoin instead of US dollar. A two emoji Elon Musk tweet could cause your home to lose 80% of its value. This is a dystopia. If tokens aren't money, what are they? For venture capitalists, cryptos are a change to arbitrage securities regulation, that is to do finance without being subject to financial rules, especially rules about whose money they're allowed to spend. The median return on a given venture capitalist investment is zero. Securities regs limit who can invest with VCs because the amount of knowledge you need to distinguish a good VC investment from doom scams is formidable, setting up a lot of everyday people to lose their life savings. But tokens let VCs bypass those rules. An asset class, again, that is another phrase Hill Harper and others are using ad nauseum. An asset class that you can buy from your portfolio, companies that looks like a security, swims like a security, and quacks like a security, but is not regulated as a security. In fact, is not regulated at all. Now, again, to the point I was making previously, this is not me making a pro-US government argument. It is not me making an argument that the current federal, you know, regulatory system or the federal government system is a good one. But what I am saying, if we're trying to develop a political struggle or an analysis or something that's good for the collective, we have to recognize the relationship, as Kwame Ture started us off with, between politics and economics, and not get caught up in the chasing the money side, not recognizing that all of it requires the prerequisite of political education and organization. Because what they're doing here is setting us up by claiming you can invest in Bitcoin and cryptocurrency. And what I've been arguing is being said better here and with more detail here, but it's simply that it is an unregulated situation that we don't want. I wouldn't recommend and suggest that we would want an unregulated wild, wild west situation of commercial exchange and investment. That is what, as he's pointing out here, and I've been arguing separately with less detail and perhaps organized arrangement of an argument, that this is what the elite have been arguing for and wanting for a long time. Venture capitalists, and so on, the biggest bankers in the world are now investing. This is why I would want to talk with Wise Intelligent about the blockchain white paper and why he's claiming that banks and central banks are worried when in fact they're investing in all of this. Because it's an unregulated way to further reap not only extract wealth or income from us, or who would be unwitting investors, but to the point of Seb Solomon, it's a great way for us to be data mined without recognizing that that's what's happening. So anyway, that is the true meaning of financial engineering and financial innovation, a way to do an end run around investor protection rules. It's a way to let sophisticated investors unload their bad bets on the public without filing an S-1 or even producing a prospectus detailing a business model. Tokens, unlike shares, can be liquidated at any time, including the moment just before the company creators just before the company craters. If fintech is the high roller section of the casino, tokens are the regular tables where everyday people get fleeced. So, I mean, there's more here, and I would really encourage others and myself included to keep investigating and reading all the links or all that is linked in this. And I'll put this thread in the show notes, so I and others can continue to follow up on this and review it. But anyway, essentially, let me let you jump in if you wanted to and raise anything. But that was essentially what I was wanting us to quickly look at as we are moved away from political organization and political power and further encouraged and induced and propagandized into this kind of you know, invest our way and new technology our way into some collective uplift. So anyway,
yeah, well, I mean, it's they mentioned something earlier in that thread, and that was about the fact that this is a casino, and he made that analogy, and it's really what we're talking about. And literally, in some instances, we may recall that over the past few years, they just made it, you know, it's now become legal basically to gamble on sports, which was yeah. a no-no before, you know, outside of, you know, like Vegas or Atlantic City or some spot like that. But now you can pretty much on your app go and, you know, because and the reason that's happening is because they need new markets to tap, because people have less wealth. But they also know that people, you know, because people have less wealth, then that will make them more susceptible to take risks like gambling. And so people get caught up in the gambling and they'll, you know, basically give up large sums of money in some instances, in many instances, and to the point where we have gambling issues all over the country. There are now TV networks and radio stations which are now dedicated specifically for gambling. I've seen TV shows where people talk apps. About fantasy and apps, you know, but fantasy football and baseball. And basically what that is now people are not even necessarily rooting for teams as much as they're rooting for players. And they take certain players from different teams and put them together on these fantasy teams.
That's right.
In order to make money. So again, all of these things are just ways that they can tap into new markets. And it's funny, you know, because we've seen this inflation, and I'm going to share my screen here in a second. I was going to bring up this article and what you were talking about to kind of just highlight what you were talking about.
And by the way, what you're talking about there, like that has boosted the stock value of the NFL and other right. major sports leagues. That's another way for them to expand by allowing the betting and the gambling and the fantasy sports, and where people, to your point, are more attached. I even saw something not too long ago that was talking about fans are increasingly attached to individual players as opposed to teams now. So yeah. So even the foundation of some of the fan bases of individual teams is being eroded in part because fans are like, I don't care about my team. I care about the team I create on my fantasy board. Mm-hmm. By the way, years ago, I messed around when they first started DraftKings, that app. I messed mm-hmm. around with it, checked it out, and then stopped immediately when I read there was an early scandal where it was exposed that employees of DraftKings had manipulated the algorithm so that to allow for certain people to win and for themselves to win. So once I saw that you could manipulate the algorithm to make it harder for people to win, I was like, I'm definitely not that I was going to stay in anyway, but I'm definitely not going to, you know, now I see what the hustle is. Like it's, you know, because it allows you to set up fantasy teams, and then you have all of the betting variables, the unders, the overs, wow, what's the word? Dag, I can't even remember now. Just went blank on it. What is it? The spread, all of that. You got all of these things that make it very difficult and make it challenging yet exciting. But more attention is being paid to all of these leagues, because people are, you know, they're personally invested, literally. Anyway, so yeah, okay, here we go.
Well, yeah, so you see the screen?
Yeah.
Okay, so I was actually getting ready to pull
Investor
up.
Summit.
Yeah, no, that's not even what I was trying to do, but I left it up there because I just found it funny because I was actually going to bring up something else, and then this is what popped up.
Okay.
So I thought you'd find that interesting.
I do. I think it's great. I hope I can go.
But this is what I was looking at. You know, U.S. consumer prices jumped 6.2% in October, the biggest inflation surge in 30 years. The CPI, the consumer price index, 6.2%, highest since 91. Stripping out food and energy. They even got a shortage in Christmas trees this year too, because of this. Wow. I just saw an article about that. But basically, it's just showing that as inflation is rising, I saw another, I'm not sure, I think it's in this article, but it, you know, whatever, as inflation is rising, people are still, that's what I was gonna talk about. There's another article where I saw where the Dollar Tree, you might be familiar with that Dollar Tree store where everything's a dollar. They're raising the prices to $1.25. you know, in the Dollar Tree. And this is amid, like,
so even the Dollar Tree is not a dollar.
It's not a dollar. It's like the dollar 25 cent tree. But they met record profit. Now they say they blame this on the fact that they were, you know, COVID and supply chain, fuel and stock in the shelves and all that stuff. But yet they made record profits, you know, last year, you know, even in spite of all of that. To your point earlier about, you know, these people making all this money. You had the picture of Bezos up there, and he, you know, he's just one of the many. But again, you know, when we look at the consumer protection agencies, the Fed, all these other, you know, institutions that are supposed to help the consumer, the citizens, you know, we have to remember the revolving door that many of these people, you know, were in government, right, that they authored some of these changes, you know, in the financial industry. You know, they were into Glass-Steagall, you know, separating the banks, you know, the investment banks from the private banks and all of that. And so they kind of merged this all together, and right along with the Deregulation Act of 1996, which was under, by the way, was under the first black president.
The first black president, yes.
Bill Clinton, you know, because before Obama, he was the first black president. You know, That's so right. All of these things are taking place. But you see, but the point is that even though as inflation surges all over the country, people are still willing, and they said this in one of the articles I read, people are still willing to pay the increase. That's what they said with Dollar Tree. People are still willing to pay the increases, you know, because these are things that people need in some cases, or believe they need in other cases. So we're starting to see how this is all coming together. And again, it only ultimately affects those, benefits those who are at the very top.
Oh, yeah, right on.
And I looked up this thing that you were talking about, green seal funds. This is Credit
Suisse. Oh yeah, thank you.
You know, they had a collapse too. This is over in Switzerland. Credit Suisse, crisis-ridden Credit Suisse, going on the offensive under the new chair. Switzerland's second biggest bank plans to refund fees on most products and services to clients on a quarterly basis, covering standard brokerage fees, discretionary mandate fees, investment fees, funds.
So this is a bailout. Is that what you're saying?
It's a bailout. It's a bailout. You know, basically. So they got a bit, and that's exactly what happened last year, which was in part how these people, just everywhere, the billionaires, is the fact that they got a bailout as well. You know, from us.
Right.
You know, we actually bailed them out. So and why?
But not even from us, because. But it's not even that, because it's beyond just from us, because it's beyond just the tax base. They literally created money out of nowhere in the Hope and CARES Act and just gave it to themselves. So, I mean, we can't even take credit for having been ripped off in that way. So all right, but listen, all right, so I know we're running a little bit over. Let me get to. All right, go ahead. So we both got more to get to. So let me just do a quick break, and then we'll come back and do a last segment wrapping up on everything. So we'll be right back here to Mix What I Like, Black Power
Media. I mix what I like.
Okay, my man. So we'll just call this the miscellaneous wrap up segment. So go ahead, you can get us started, and then we can get to whatever I have left as well.
Okay. Well, this is just something on the Chris Cuomo piece. I just thought this was extremely
interesting. That's a perfect segue too. This is going to be a perfect segue.
Because I mean, this is people don't know Chris Cuomo, who was the brother of I want to call the boy Mario, but I know that ain't his name. That was his father. The former governor of Andrew Cuomo, scandal. Yeah. And they used to have a bro fest like almost every night on CNN. So I heard, because I don't watch CNN, he was on there a whole lot. Cuomo had his brother, the governor, on, and it was kind of like a conflict of interest, because he's supposed to be covering his brother and he wasn't covering him fully, because at the time when he was being praised, because simply because he was in seemingly in opposition to Trump in terms of COVID and his COVID response. You know, meanwhile, you had, you know, elders in nursing homes dying while he's writing a book, you know, praising himself and calling himself some sort of hero. Not to mention the fact that he was, you know, in the midst of all this sexual misconduct and the scandals there. And so basically, we've come to find out that his brother Chris, who also is a lawyer as well as being a host on the TV, he actually was trying to get information about the accusers to try to, you know, use it against them. And he was digging around and so forth about it. But I think what's even more troubling, but it's not surprising to us, was the coverage. And so I saw this piece from The View, and they were talking about it. And there's this one sister on there, Jane Colston, I think. And I know people are mad, you know, they say, well, she's a libertarian or whatever. I don't really care. Again, I don't care what the person's politics are, if they're telling the truth, you know, in terms of particular issues. And she took them to task. Because I just wanted to share this conversation because I think it was fascinating and I think it kind of shows, it's a great illustration of how things are covered and not covered and how things are emphasized and not emphasized. Now Chris Cuomo has been indefinitely suspended by CNN because of the fact that he was doing what he was doing. But you just take a listen at how some of these people try to cover this this particular issue.
I think you got to share the sound on the thing. I'm not hearing the sound.
Okay.
You got to click the the dialogue box that says share sound. When you click share the tab, there should be another one that says share sound in the little corner.
Okay. All right. So let me do that. I didn't know. I had
you're using Chrome, right? You're using Chrome, right?
Yeah, I'm using Chrome.
Because that's the only browser StreamYard allows you to share sound through, which is another problem I've been struggling with them behind the scenes with, you know, as I continue to struggle with the good folks at StreamYard over this platform.
Is it video file or is it just share screen?
No, you're sharing a tab. Share screen, share tab, and in the corner of the share tab screen box, you'll see a box for click to share sound.
Okay, I got it. Share tab audio. Okay, I see.
Share tab and then right. Yep.
Okay, so I'll do that. All right. For some reason it's not.
And you do know that Whoopi Goldberg, Whoopi Goldberg actually narrates the new Oliver Stone documentary about the CIA's involvement in killing JFK. It was really weird, and it's a very good documentary. A fascinating documentary. Did you know that they had teams similar to the team that included Oswald as the patsy? They had other patsies and teams set up in Chicago and in I want to say Tampa was the other city. If JFK had gone there, there was other people set up to be the patsy that would if it had happened there. But Oswald was the patsy for Dallas, and that's why. And it's just so much more information. It's so obvious. I mean, at this point, if people didn't already believe, like if you watch this documentary, it is crazy how bad it is. Anyway, so there's the connection to Whoopi and The View. Because I was shocked. I said, Whoopi?
Yeah, interesting. Well, here they are having this discussion about Chris Cuomo right there, and just say a couple things. I want to continue because this is a fascinating. Just look at how they're trying to cover it. First of all, talking about Mario Cuomo, he was a great governor. Now we know that's absolutely false. This is not true. And these people this is a small circle in the media. So a lot of these people know each other, even though they may be on different networks and so on and so forth. You know, so that's one thing. But then I don't know. It's like this and that. And he's a good guy. But then Sonny Hostin, you see what she did? You know, is it illegal? It's not a question about it being illegal. It's a question about ethics. You know, so it's not about, should he be fired for what he did? And then talking about Chris Cuomo, you know, he should be fired for what he did because he was trying to provide information to slander accusers. And again, I go back to the Tara Reid situation as opposed to, say, the other guy who was running for the Supreme Court, who ended up getting put in there by
what's
Trump.
His name?
The drunk guy,
Kavanaugh.
You know, Brett Kavanaugh. Again, when it was Brett Kavanaugh, you know, it was like you believe all women, all of that. But then when it was Tara Reid, then it's like, well, I don't know. We're blaming the victim.
I don't know.
We're seeing because they like Cuomo and they now this and that. They're not even talking about the fact that you know that this was around victims, women like themselves that they supposedly talk about believing them all the time. You know, that he's trying to shame those women, those same women that if it was Trump or if it's Kavanaugh or somebody like that, all of a sudden now we got to be hardcore and everything. We support all the women. But because it's a Democrat or somebody, you know, that they like or their friends, now they want to try to cover it up. But I just wanted to go back because I wanted to get this sister, Jane Colston's response, because she really comes in. First, there's another woman here. Now, this white woman in the yellow dress, she had a more accurate take, I think, as well. That's pretty much. But you see how they try to wash their hands of it and, you know, I'm not going to judge. It's, you know, it's not my job. It's seeing it. Now, if it's anybody else, again, you know, they'd have gone in. But because it's one of, but it just highlights how there's an incestuous relationship between, you know, all these people in journalism, particularly in the lamestream media. So it's just another reason why we need to kind of take a better look at you know, that whole situation.
Let me just for the record, so people who may hear this later on podcasts or watch this later in the replay, because just in case we get a copyright thing,
the
video might get silenced. So I just want to let people know. We'll put send me the link in the private chat and I'll post the link in the show notes so people can go and watch the whole clip on their own if they don't get a chance to hear it or see it when this goes later. I don't know if that's going to happen, but just in case. If there's a gap or some silence, that's what it is. But no, but I think you make a good point. And this is actually a good segue to something I want to get in what will be the last segment we'll do today on political prisoners, because I think it relates to not only how the mainstream media covers this issue and others, but how the so-called alternative spaces are relating to these kinds of topics. Because in the alternative spaces, the only reason I know about these stories, so this goes back to the whole thing about Jimmy Dore, I haven't watched Dore in a minute. But I go to those outlets to get this kind of news. Because I'm not watching CNN, to your point. Mm-hmm. So, and when I'm watching these alternatives, am I lagging all of a sudden?
I think so. Yeah, you just froze. The chat, do y'all see Dr. Ball? Or was it, because I don't know if it's my thing or not. Do y'all see Dr. Ball? Okay. I'm not sure. Can somebody answer? Can you hear me? Yeah, because he's definitely frozen on my end. So just let us know. Okay, so it looks like you are frozen. So we get Dr. Ball back here. We're trying to figure this out. You know, this technology, it does what it does. But this is iMiXWhatiLike, and we're here with you on Fridays. And we just I just finished sharing that piece about the Views take on the Cuomo situation. Mm-hmm. Andrew, you almost came back. The Andrew Cuomo and Chris Cuomo situation, where Chris Cuomo was trying to provide information to his about his brother's accuser, and he's been indefinitely suspended by CNN, and they were debating whether or not he should be fired, and then
I mix what I like, what I like, what I like, what I like.
All right, everybody, we're back again. Try this, work this out.
That was so my bad, man. It must have been the copyright cops that got us, man. It's probably me sharing that thing. I didn't realize that, but
no, that will probably be a problem later. But what was the problem now is that I have just so many issues with my tech over here that it's just they just keep compiling. We just have to. I'm just gonna have to. Anyway, okay. I don't know exactly where we left off. Yeah, definitely shout out to everybody who stuck around, and at least everything will be time stamped and the podcast audio will get edited. But so this little gap won't be too much of an issue. But yeah, all I was really trying to do was to develop this quick segue to a couple to talk finally, ultimately about political prisoners, a couple issues with political prisoners that I wanted to not leave today without addressing, but it relates in one specific instance, it relates to a story, let's see here, about Mutulu Shakur. So the bridge I was trying to build there very quickly was that the white mainstream media in this issue around Cuomo is finding ways to be critical of the individual without being critical of the institution. Mm-hmm. The alternative white, I don't know, left or whatever that I watch has raised this issue of Cuomo as well to be critical of the mainstream that they are now claiming to be an alternative to. Mm-hmm. And within that struggle, and this is where I was making the reference specifically to Jimmy Dore, who I honestly haven't watched in a while now. But he used to have, he and Glenn Greenwald and Aaron Maté have had a very righteous and justifiable critique of The Intercept. Mm. Glenn Greenwald is a former co-founder of The Intercept, left The Intercept in a big brouhaha over the way the editorial staff censored him because he was being critical of Joe Biden before the election. So he left. And they've been critical of The Intercept for a lot of the bad coverage they've done on Syria, on Russiagate, on Biden, and so on and so on and so forth. But as I and we have pointed out, they also have their own blind spots, in particular as it relates to political prisoners. So when I saw this story the other day, of course I would want to cover this for on its own, but also for this issue here around this question of politics and journalism. So The Intercept, being justifiably criticized, as I just mentioned, for what it was not doing, has been doing some coverage, and I think some good coverage of our political prisoners, Sundiata Okoli recently, as we talked about, but also here just yesterday around Mutulu Shakur. And before I get into the more important details around Mutulu, I just want to finalize that point by saying that all of these people who do good work, from Jimmy Dore at times to the Gray Zone to, you know,
Crystal Ball in them, all of these people mm-hmm. that they may do good things here and there. When it comes to this issue, they're nowhere. So I even just saw Breonna Joy Gray and others are doing a big thing coming up for that whistleblower who got, I forgot his name, the white dude who got in trouble with Chevron. It's actually an important case. I should do more to pay attention to it myself, but they're doing this big fundraiser around his mm-hmm. prosecution and persecution. They'll talk, of course, about Julian Assange, but even after being specifically reached out to cover Mumia and other people like Mutulu, who's unfortunately at the end of their lives or closer to the end of their lives and still in needing relative freedom, they're silent. So I'm saying you're going to talk all this trash about The Intercept, but you're not even doing, you won't do on this issue what good work they're willing to do. So anyway.
Right. So again, it's extending my point, a point that I've been making over and over again the past, few weeks anyway, is they're not gonna go for political prisoners because they only fought for the freedom or primarily fought for the freedom of black people. Like they are black political prisoners, unabashedly black. Now, of course, in general, they have varying politics within the same spectrum. But for the most part, they're freedom fighters for black people. And again, you can't do anything positive just for black people. You can't do, I don't give a damn what area of human activity you talk about. If you do anything specifically for black people, you're not going to be welcome in whatever camp.
And even when you involve, as this story we'll talk a little bit about, white allies. So even when your work involves Marilyn Buck or David Gilbert or others, they don't get covered. You don't get covered. None of that gets covered
because they were fighting for black people.
That's right, and that's again why. Rittenhouse got ultimately. The specifics of the law notwithstanding, ultimately mm-hmm. Rittenhouse was acquitted because he was accused nominally. Of killing people who were nominally working mm-hmm. with or in solidarity with black people. So
even though cases when they really weren't. I mean that's
what I'm saying.
That's like you got to stop and look at that for a second. Like they weren't even really there for us, but yet just because the optics, made it appear that they were even some tangentially connected to helping us. That was to, they had to go.
That's why I keep saying nominally and ostensibly and theoretically. Really So anyway, but as it says here, eligible for release in 2016, Mutulu Shakur remains behind bars with worsening cancer. So just a little bit of this story, and of course we'll put the link in the show notes, encouraging people to not only read this and share it as well. Mutulu Shakur was not sentenced to die in prison, but die in prison he may. The 71-year-old icon of the Black liberation struggle has been incarcerated for over three decades. The rules governing his 1988 sentencing set his presumed release date for 2016. Yet, despite an impeccable institutional record, he has been denied release by the Federal Parole Commission 9 times. He remains behind bars while an incurable cancer is now spreading through his bone marrow. Reforms and policy shifts in certain state parole systems, including New York's, have seen a long overdue release of a number of aging former Black Panthers like Herman Bell and Jaleel Muntakeen. In recent years, held in the federal system. However, longtime prisoners like Shakur face further layers of institutional intransigence and procedural arcana. Shakur, the stepfather of the late rapper Tupac Shakur, was convicted of racketeering conspiracy charges alongside a number of Black liberationists and leftist allies for his involvement in the 1981 robbery of a Brinks armored truck during which a guard and two police officers were killed. He was also convicted for aiding the prison escape of Assata Shakur. Yet the demand for his release now has nothing to do with the political underpinnings of his arrest, trial, and conviction. If any party is displaying ideological excesses, it is the federal justice system apparently acting against its own standards in the case of a Black liberation elder. And actually, that was in response to an argument that it was his own political behavior and arguments, including actually, what was the line he used?
or maybe it comes up later. But that, anyway, let me just keep going. Shakur is aging and ill. He has served his extensive prison time and has accepted full responsibility for his actions. Like other long imprisoned Black liberation elders, including Mumia Abu-Jamal and Sundiata Okoli, the alleged grounds for Shakur's continued incarceration are without merit, even according to the purported logics of our brutal criminal legal system. The Department of Justice's own risk assessment tool categorizes Shakur as the absolute lowest risk of recidivism. The rates of reoffending for people in his age group are already vanishingly small. A top oncologist's recent medical declaration on the state of Shakur's health stated that even with ameliorative cancer treatment, he would likely die within 2 or 3 years. In the highly possible event that treatment fails, Shakur is expected to live fewer than 11 months. His mandatory release date is 2024, but his family, friends, and supporters believe he cannot survive that long. With a accordant sense of urgency, Shakur's legal team is currently trying every available legal, salutary, and bureaucratic avenue to see him released. Just a little bit more here. Their stated reasons for denying Shakur's parole have been no less than absurd. They said, for example, that Shakur lacked the appropriate remorse for his actions and remained a threat to the general public because he had signed off letters signed off letters to friends and supporters with the phrase stiff resistance, the very resistance to injustice that has made Shakur a trusted mentor to dozens of formerly incarcerated men. Stephen Henshaw, one of the numerous men who found a mentor in Shakur while imprisoned alongside him, told me how Shakur was unique in his ability to break through the extreme race-based gang segregation encouraged in federal prisons. Henshaw, who is white and has mixed race children, now works as a truck driver and owes his determination to Shakur's inspiration. And I can't help you, I'm not thrilled with that categorization of his children. But anyway, anyone who has been in the yard with him knows that he solves problems and builds bridges, Henshaw told me. He has the gift for helping people see themselves. The commissioner also cited an alleged serious violation. He was put on loudspeaker during a call with a professor in her class in 2013. It's not clear why this constituted a violation, let alone a serious one, that the subject of the class was Shakur's support for the founding of a Truth and Reconciliation Commission in the United States to reckon through peaceful conflict resolution with histories of racism made for a grim irony. So I'll stop there and leave, again, the link in the show notes. But I wanted to not only commend The Intercept for all of its, I'm sure, failings journalistically for covering this story and encouraging people, as we will, to make their voices known in defense of Mutulu and other political prisoners. Just be reminded that their imprisonment, and I was just looking to see if they had a link to something for him, but we'll post that in the show notes as well. Their continued imprisonment is just a reminder of what has not really changed fundamentally in the society and what kinds of change still needs to occur. So, any thoughts on this one?
I think it just highlights sophistication again. The Intercept is not necessarily what it used to be. It's not something that we look to, but when they do something that is valuable, we give them we don't necessarily got to give them props. We just acknowledge it. But I thought it was interesting. The hook that they used in that story was in order to get sympathy, I guess, for their white liberal, mostly wannabe liberal audiences. They talked about the white man, who has biracial children, because he's got to be the hook to make Shakur a sympathetic, figure for them. So because they got to make him legit, because again, he only fought for black people. But if you can tie in this white guy, who's got biracial children, now we give you the legitimacy. So they had to use a little hook there in order to appeal to the sensibilities of their audience, or their number one audience. So I found that interesting.
That is interesting. I think it's a very good point. And that's again why I'm not, one of the reasons why I'm not thrilled with this definition of the children is so-called mixed race. That doesn't tell us enough about what's really going on. But to your point, I think that's clearly done to to highlight of all the people you could have spoken to about the impact of Mutulu Shakur, you would want to highlight that. The same thing is done with Jonathan and George Jackson, not only in terms of you know, Jonathan's mother, but I mean Jonathan's wife, and white wife, and George's ability to organize across racial lines in prisons. The same thing is done there, because I think, again, if the focus is they were struggling for Black people, that wouldn't be enough. Now, I find that not to be Fred Hampton. Oh, absolutely. And same thing with Malcolm. Obviously, the same thing. They try to do the same thing there as well. I did want to also just point out that, again, and we'll link to this as well, because encourage people to sign up with the Freedom Archives prisoner newsletter per their release, not release, but the distribution of the latest, I guess it is the latest release of their newsletter. We have a statement from Leonard Peltier, where I won't read the whole thing, but it will certainly provide the link. But it starts off where he says, "Greetings, relatives. Each year as November nears, I try to think back on all that has happened in my world in the past 12 months. And I know that in my world, I can only see a very small part of what is happening on the outside. For me, this year somehow seems to carry more weight than usual. I have passed ever so slowly into the world of the elderly. I am now closer to 80 than to 70. The truth is, I've never believed I would live this long. I was just past 31 years old when I came to prison. It was almost half a century ago. My body is now the body of an old man, and it is harder to try to keep myself from being overtaken by sickness or depression or loneliness. They are constant companions here. I keep them at arm's length, and I know that I can never let them overtake me. If I allow that to happen, it will be the end. There is no mercy here, no compassion." We'll link to this obviously as well. Encourage people to sign the petition. And I just want to remind everybody of all of the wildness that is included in the trial of Leonard Peltier and his imprisonment is the fact that the FBI acknowledged in court that they did not know who killed their agents that day. At Pine Ridge, and they snatched up Peltier as just one that they could pin it on and punish for that act, and his involvement with the American Indian Movement, his support of the Black Panther Party, his correct analysis of this country's history and its treatment of people has kept him imprisoned all this time. And you know, so I read that, it's painful. And I'm, you know, terribly sorry that he and others like him continue to suffer this way. And it bothers me terribly that so many outlets refuse to give any attention to him and others like that. So we'll continue to try to do that here. And I will again put this all in the show notes and encourage people to click all those links and support as best they can Leonard and Mutulu, Sundiata, and Mumia and the rest. So. Anyway, those were the last, actually, other than one little bit of fun story that I'll really close out this morning with, that was something I wanted to make sure we got to today, and wanted to come back despite those tech difficulties to get to. So, and that's that. Yeah,
shout out to Leonard Peltier, man. I mean, the fact that he still has that fight in him, you know, even as he's talking about where he is right now, the fact that he has no back down in him at 81 years old. I know he was an elder, but I didn't realize he was like that much of an elder. But 81 years old, man, it's amazing. The fight that he still has.
It's just crazy to see. I mean, it's like, how long do these people need to? I mean, wow. But again, the point is they have to be punished. Yeah, that's it.
There's no mercy. They're not like us. We're not the same. I mean, because we as hardcore as we are, you know, and we do still have some humanity. And you know, we do feel for people's pain. You know, unfortunately, that's almost a fault. I wish
it is.
Didn't.
Yeah, I agree.
That includes myself, you know.
I hate you.
These people have no humanity. They have no fucking, and they have no empathy at all, man. It's amazing when you just think about, like, that's colder than the white man. I mean, that's
colder than the white man.
Wow.
Incredible. All right, one more quick break, and then let's wrap up on a little bit of a lighter note here, a little bit at least, and then we'll be on our way right back in a second.
What I like.
All right, good people. I don't know to what extent folks care or have followed this, but oh, you know what? I gotta fix what my issue is here. Oh man, this is super frustrating. But okay, so this is I'll send you this is because this is the tweet here, but let me get the copy the link and then put it in the private chat, and then we'll come back and we'll let Kaba share his screen and share that. But for those who don't know, there is audio with it, because that's why I can't share it from my setup right now, because I want people to hear RG3 now. And I don't know to what extent others paid any attention to this, but we might have to do this quick, because I think my computer is dying again. Uh-oh. This is crazy. Yeah, it's really wild, man. Let's see.
You got me?
Let me add this to the stream. All right, so go ahead if you can.
What's up, guys? I'm so excited to announce that I wrote a book, and it's coming out in August 2022, titled Surviving Washington. Now, every experience that I've ever had has made me a better husband, a better father, and a better player. But I want you to take this journey with me as I walk you through one of the most dysfunctional franchises in all of sports. I'm going to tell you the truth about what happened in that playoff game in 2012 against Seattle. I'm going to detail the medical mismanagement that I received during my time in Washington. I'm going to open your eyes to the sexual harassment that permeated the walls of that building and give you a deep dive into a power struggle between one of the most powerful coaches in all of sports and an owner that many of you want gone. They say the truth will set you free. So here it is, unfiltered. Pre-order now.
Woo! So, look, I know my computer's probably about to die, so we'll get into this at another time, and the book's not going to come out till August of 2022. But I was just very happy to see that this is coming. I hope it does add to the weight that will push Dan Snyder out of
this is for the hater in you this time. Means I always be true. Gonna last forever. Yeah,
that's it. That's it.
Jared Ball's theme song.
Hey, thank you very much. It is. Look, Dan Snyder, before even the Kaepernick stuff, Dan Snyder pushed me out of support for that league. I don't watch anymore. That team I used to support my entire life. I don't anymore. And the RG3 whole saga I watched and was very attuned to as it was happening. So when my tech is better and I get myself together and we have plenty of time, I'll come back to talk about that another time. But for now, let me just say thank you, Brother Kaba. Thank you to April Silver and all of her guests. Thanks to all the people in the chat and all of those who stayed through all of the struggles this morning. And to those who will hear and see this later, I appreciate you as well. Please do hit the like, share, subscribe. Check out our Patreon at blackpowermedia.org. Tune in to Brother Kaba's show, WPFW.org, Monday 3 to 5, African Deep Thought edition of Jazz and Justice. And brother, thank you very much, man. I'll see you next week and see everybody else Monday.
Thank you. Don't hold it against me. I'm about to go sing some Christmas songs for some money. They pay good these holiday seasons. And plus, it'll give me a chance to stop being a closet lover of Christmas music, because, you know, I can't front. For years, I was in the closet with my love for Christmas music and singing it to myself, because, you know, because who could deny, you know, the fireside is blazing bright. We're caroling through the night. Who can deny that? Who can deny that?
Who can deny that? If you're going to get Christmas, Donnie brought you Christmas.
Start with that. Got to start with that.
And can't we appreciate no your can't get blacker than Donnie. He's on my wall next to Asada.
I'm saying though.
Anyway. All right, man. Appreciate you, man. Voice sounded lovely as usual. Go hook him up, man. We'll catch you later. Peace if you're willing to fight for it. Like Fred said, we'll catch you next time here at I Mix What I Like at Black Power Media. Thank you.
I mix what I like, what I like, what I like, what I like. What I like, what I like, what I like, what I like.